second time somebody changed my life. I was guilty.
Hello, Amanda.
But my life was saved that day. I found myself a father, a leader, a teacher.
You must meet Death. In order to be reborn.
Help me.
What is the cure for cancer, Eric?
Those who don't appreciate life do not deserve life.
The cure for death itself. The answer is immortality. By creating a legacy, by living a life worth remembering, you become immortal.
Hi!
Hello!
Hey!
Woo!
Would you invite all of us?
Yes!
You guys are all so quiet
out there.
We're in awe.
Bring it on.
There are no rules.
What? Can't function
it's
that
a free for all.
I guess I can pick up people.
Okay.
So, Mr. Bell, there's so many movies where the villain is overly menacing or becomes overly menacing, but you managed to maintain this absolutely amazing subtleness throughout every single song. What do you channel to maintain that level of subtlety?
Subtle menace.
I like that.
I've got two good band names to
name. I'm going to trademark that right now.
Somebody asked me that before, earlier today. He said in Saw 2, how there was so, the police had all the power, but you seem to have so much strength amidst that. And how did you do that in the situation you were in? Can you hear me in the back?
No.
Okay. Is that better?
Yes.
Okay. And I just said, well, John knows a lot about them that they don't know that he knows. And what was it? Subtle power?
Subtle menace,
yeah. So that creates strength. Right there, when you know things about people that they don't know that you know. And
are you writing notes? know things about them, they don't know you know.
That's right, yeah. You know, they say that about lawyers. They say lawyers never ask a question that they don't know the answer to before they ask it. So there was all kinds of things that I knew about Detective Matthews, and about actually where we were. If you've seen Saw 2, he thought we were in a kitchen, when in fact we were in a service elevator, which was designed as a kitchen. So there were all kinds of games going on that he didn't know about, that I knew about. So there's a certain humor in that. You can call it subtle menace. I call it human.
So, do either one of you had any idea, not only the impact you're going to have on a horror culture, but I think the explosion of escape rooms is attributed to Saul as well. Did you have any idea what an impact you were going to have?
The explosion of what?
Escape rooms. Because I think escape rooms come from
yeah.
Saul, obviously.
Yeah. No. For me, it was, I was in the Czech Republic doing a television series when Saw 1 came out, and I wasn't really paying any attention to how the film was doing and its results, because in my mind, it was over. And So no, I don't think, I don't know if Shawnee was thinking about, but you know, that having been said, when they called me and said they were going to do a second film, I was like, that's good, because I always felt like if you were going to sit through what you sat through in Saw 1, I wanted to know more what was going on in John's head. And the fact that in Saw 2, I was able to get up off the floor and make some stuff up with Donnie Wahlberg about what John's concerns were. And they were multiple. One of the most interesting ones, I think, was if you knew the exact moment of your own death, how would it change how you live your life?
I was in the screening at Sundance Film Festival, the first screening, and it was awesome. There was nothing subtle about it. When he stood up off the floor, the audience just fell out of their seats screaming, and we were like, and I was sitting next to the producers and James Wan, and they were like, that you knew. Can you hear me back there? You knew this was big. Yeah, that was pretty exciting, that moment when he stood up and the way he stood. He does everything. Very subtle. Subtle menace.
Subtle menace.
Zoom right over here.
What is it like to be considered a villain synonymous with names like the Joker and to be the only person that ever played that?
All of that, being considered anything, all happens outside me. You know, that's a result of something that's not in my mind at all. I focus on what I can do something with and creatively. And what did you ask me?
How is it being
well,
awesome?
We're talking like 7 movies and a half, so I mean, you know how big this is now. What is it like to be a villain? Do you consider a villain synonymous with a name like the Joker?
Oh.
Everybody knows who takes on.
One of the most beautiful things about playing this role has been that I've had the opportunity to show that there's good and bad in all of us. And if you can make people think, then you've accomplished something that sometimes historically in horror films has not happened. But it's very plot driven, and it's about the scares and the twists and the turns. I got lucky with this because I was working with actors and actresses, and you know, we all, between a bunch of us and the people who were making the film, were smart enough to realize that there is always the possibility of creating another layer. You have to integrate it into, obviously it's a horror movie, so you need to have the traps and the gore, or whatever you want to call it, but the subtext of the whole movie was a result of ongoing work with the directors and actors, and sometimes you change something very subtly and very slightly, and it's huge. It just jumps off the screen. And when you surround thoughtful concepts with the intensity of those traps and the situations those people are in, when you surround thoughtful concepts with that, it makes those concepts jump out and it makes people think. And we were in an environment where we could create that, and it ended up on the screen. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes it gets edited and changed and chopped, and the rhythms are changed. But in this case, a lot of what we worked out as a group ended up on the screen. And that's what, for me, that's what was the best part of making soft films. Those concepts, those moments when people thought, I see what he's coming up. I don't necessarily agree with him. I wouldn't necessarily do it that way, but I get it. And if you can create that in a horror film, that's great, I think.
Since we're all friends here, do you guys have any thoughts you'd like to express about the new Saw reboot coming from Chris Rock and Samuel L. Jackson?
I can't wait to see it. I mean, I hope it includes him. It always should. It
has to.
But, I'd love it to include me, but whether it does or not, I can't wait to see that. What about you guys? Pretty cool. Tobin, what do you think?
I think there's a lot of very creative, very powerful people in this world, and I'm sure they're going to do something that's fascinating. And I can't really say much more than that. There's always been a lot of secrecy that's shrouded these projects, and this one's no exception. But, you take Chris Rock, and you take Sam Jackson, and you take Darren, who is involved, and they're going to come up with something that's pretty amazing. So we're watching it develop. The script is en route as we talk.
En route where? To you? En route to you?
En route to the universe.
All right, thanks guys.
Yep.
Can I come up here? I'm not sure if I'm going to be
well. Absolutely.
Maya. Yeah, hi. Hi. Okay. I was just wondering, what kind of, off-screen work went into developing the relationship between your two characters? Because it's such an interesting and complicated relationship. Really, it's just part of the movie that stands out to me so much in these games.
There are probably our walking paths on sidewalks in Toronto, from walking and talking. There's a photo booth that we took some hysterical pictures in. We really just, it's really fun working with Tobin because his approach, and I think we looked into each other because we both kind of, I might have screwed myself when Lee was like, yeah, I'm gonna make her a super villain. And I was like, well, but like, human. I should have gone the super villain, but it was more fun to work with Tobin because he's like, could have easily been, master and slave and protege, but he was like, so how do they spend their time? I was like, yeah, exactly, like making that first scene when I come in. I mean, yeah, I have to work with the material. I'm like tiny, so how am I gonna come in and be menacing, Well, and I never wanted it, I can't play an idea. I mean, I've done it in my worst acting, and it's painful to do and more painful to watch. But you're screwed if you're playing an idea, especially like a tiny girl like me playing like the idea of a. So we just focused on the humanness up there. connection. And it was like philosophical, you know? It was a, Saw 3 is a love story. And so we just, that was our rehearsal. We just walked and talked and did what they would do, you know? And then the opening scene, I was buying groceries, wearing his hoodie, just happened to be subtly menacing because it was kind of big. And that's how we approached it. And so it made it like, oh, okay, I could act that. Otherwise it would be painful in a different way. It was painful watching him have a seizure and have brain surgery. It was really painful.
You see how she just put her hand on my arm? Just reached and put her hand on my arm. It was not, there was nothing in Saw 3 about their relationship. So it had to be done with looks and touches and small things like that. Which is what happens in life. Often writers know the direction they want to go, but they don't quite know how to get there. And when we began to work on Saw 3, there was the shape of things, the idea of things, as Shawnee said, when you play an idea, you can, it can be a trap, not to make a pun. You don't want to play an idea. You want to fill in the details of the idea, because the smallest detail often tells more than the big show of something. So that's what we did. We worked on the dialogue. What would you say under those circumstances? Well, I wouldn't say that. You know, which is what basically we did in Saw 2 with Donnie Wahlberg. Donnie Wahlberg was an actor who would, if he didn't believe something, he wouldn't say it. You know, and I'd say, well, he said, I would never fucking say that. You know, I said, well, what would you say? And he'd say, well, I'd say, fuck you. I'd say, all right, so, and by the way, you did say that in Saw 3, I think. Didn't you say something like that?
I might have said that.
Yeah, yeah. So, it's an exploration. That we were fortunate enough to be in an environment where the people we were working with were smart enough to go, that's better.
Yep.
Two-parter. What was it like working on The Stand? And also with the remake coming out, who do you think should play your character?
There's another Stand coming out.
The big older James Marsden already cast in it.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Is Whoopi playing
Mother Abigail?
Irma P. Hall. Did she play? Was that movie I worked with Irma? Or was that in so many movies? It's been a lot of decades. The Stand. What was it like working on The Stand?
Yeah, problem.
That was pretty awesome because I had I started acting when I was 8 years old, and in fact, I just passed this booth walking here, and it's this actor Mark Price, and I go, I know this face, and then I look down for like younger pictures. We did a cabaret show together when we were kids. Like that nobody knew. Probably all the parents just went to it. You know, my kids up on the stage. You know. But Mark Price. I mean, it's been a long time. But anyway, so I was like between being a kid and being a woman, and I wasn't working for the first time. You know, I had like this lull, and I almost moved back to my grandma's in North Carolina. And and then all of a sudden I get this call. I had auditioned for it like months ago, and I get this call from saying you have an offer to. I was like, what? Well, Diane Lane was supposed to have that part, and she got pregnant.
Yeah.
And by the time they filmed the Las Vegas stuff, which was like months after, she would have been showing. So Rob Lowe was bummed because he really wanted her to do it, but that's okay. And I was just balls to the wall. I mean, when by the time I got to that, you know, I had nothing to lose. And a lot of that was just improvised in the moment. You know, the shoe, I was just so pissed. I threw that shoe and then I go running after him and I'm like, ding, 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 ding. It was so funny, but it wasn't planned, you know. So we had a ball on that movie. It was really fun. And Vegas was really fun. And who should play Julie Lowry? I don't know, I should read the novel first. And then watch some young actors. I should climb out of my hole and to answer that question. I just read The Body by Stephen King. Except the one unnecessary sex scene that was in there. I'm like, I could let my boy read that book, but I ripped out those pages. Because the rest of it was pretty good. It's a good book. One of the best opening paragraphs I've read in a book. In that book, The Body. To answer your questions and more.
All right, next one.
Just want to thank you all both for the impact that you all had in the film industry. And like I just mentioned, you told me in the signings, it's been going on 15 years that we've been doing the Saw franchise. We can't thank you both enough that what you all had on impact on the franchise. Having said that, it's been a fun journey watching your all's careers go on now. Like we go, for instance, like James Wan, Lee Whannell start off, come in. Now look at James right now. He's directing big films as Aquaman, Lee's writing his other horror franchises. It's been fun on that experience. So, what was your all's thoughts on Majora the Impact? And my second question would be is, do you have any fun Darren Lynn Bousman stories that you don't like to tell?
It's fun to torture Darren.
It's been as much an experience for me meeting horror fans for the last 15 years as anything else. It's been an introduction for me to the passion and intelligence and the way you integrate horror into your lives as a hobby and as a pastime. It's more than just going to the movies. It's something that's close to your heart. So having a chance over the last period of many years to get to know horror fans and get to know their passion for the genre, for me, has been revealing and amazing. So I feel like, in some way, I feel like a visitor into this world, you know, like, I always feel welcome in it and happy to be with you.
Can you get off the phone?
Wow. So that's, you know, all I can tell you is from my point of view, it's every aspect of it has been marvelous, starting with the creativity on the set, working with the artists that I've worked with. 15 years, amazing, you know. It just goes to show you, and I might make this point, you never know where something is going to lead. So anytime you have an opportunity to say yes to something, say yes, because sometimes it doesn't look like it's going anywhere, and then before you know it, it becomes something. And I'm not saying say yes to things you don't want to do, but you know what I'm saying. The road is not always a direct one. It sometimes is circuitous.
That's circular?
It's wandering.
About Amanda being put in the game Dead by Daylight with a bunch of
other famous slashers? The only feeling I have about that stuff is like, bummed they didn't call me, you know, because she's... Huh? Oh, awesome. See, I think like anything to do with Amanda should be me. So that's all. Well, there's that. I got that going for me. Yeah, I mean, I'm glad. It's like I'm stoked that she has that impact, you know, and that young women connect with her. You know, that's pretty cool. I wish I could have done those things, but just to be consistent with her, because she's kind of mine. You know, after James and Lee's. John Kramer's. Was that a
setting? Did I answer your question?
And to do with Amanda, talk about things not being in the script. A lot of what was being talked about in Saw 2, when Amanda was in the house, and I was talking to Detective Matthews, I was talking about Amanda and what he did with and to Amanda without talking about it. He knew what I was talking about, but we never talked about it on screen specifically. So that fed into John's relationship with Amanda in Saw 3, which also never ended up. I mean, it ended up on the screen in the smallest, most subtle ways. But so in other words, what I'm saying is it doesn't have to all be in the words to be there. And what happened in 2 with Matthews led to John's relationship with Amanda in 3. And I hope that read, because it was very much in my mind. And I always had rich ideas about how John and Amanda spent their time in the evenings and what went on between them and what they talked about and all of those kinds of things, none of which ever ended up in the films. But if you know that, then know it, because it will read. The camera sees everything. It doesn't miss anything. So if you make it up, then it's there, whether you ever speak it or not.
So you back there.
Talk a little bit about John and Amanda's relationship. How do you guys characterize it in your heads? I think in Saw 3, we saw obviously some jealousy from Amanda when others were getting the attention. How do you guys see that relationship in your head? If you had to label it, what would you label it?
For me, the specifics are not something I would want to talk to you about, but I can tell you that there was love there.
Okay.
Whatever form it took, there was a connection and love for me, and a need. And in intimacy, in whatever way. It's a barren world that they lived in, and there was warmth brought to that. And I don't think it did any harm to bring that warmth.
I got a feeling of a protective vibe from
Oh, yeah.
You think?
Yeah. Talk about the right one on your back, yeah. Even though I screwed it up.
That's where it's all about Warp, was in how he wanted her to succeed and how he wanted to be protective of her. And what she was seeing John go through, he was feeling her pain too.
Well, they cared for one another.
They cared for one another. They were kind to each other and caring. And that's pretty rare. Yeah, and the jealousy just, you know, love is terrifying.
It was very natural.
It was easy to act. And that's great, because you come into a movie where it's like, you're going to be a super villain, and you like look like a fairy, and you know, you just go like, oh, how am I going to pull this? Can't force that. So it was really a relief to approach it that way.
And I think we got close enough personally so that we were able to connect. When you're surrounded by 50 people who are there gainfully employed because of what you're doing at that moment, that's very distracting. So you need, and as I said, the camera sees everything. So if you're not connected, the camera sees it. It sees, it might just be slight, but it's huge. If you are connected, it feels that way. And so we did our best to just get to know each other and feel comfortable enough and trusting enough so that you could see it and we could express it without it feeling weird.
It was very organic. You guys had this projection of like you're very much on your own island together.
I'm glad that came across.
It's absolutely.
Beautiful confines. Yes. Subtle menace. You're gonna walk away from this one today.
So I'm gonna stand. So we talked a lot about how your character bond was influenced by like your personal bond and how it all just kind of created this beautiful image of the characters that you two are and how much you depend on each other. Have you had, separately, any connection like that with anybody else that you've worked with?
Are you trying to ask if he's cheated on me? I'm just wondering where you're going with this.
He's done so many movies. I mean, it's...
Both of us have worked with, we're kind of, I hate to call us, I won't say old times.
Veterans.
I've been lucky to work with some amazing people. I mean, I could just, like, John Candy, Ted Danson, Charlie Sheen, Tobin Bell. But the ones that stand out are like what Tobin says, the ones where you connect. Acting is a team sport, and so it's like you just want to like grab on to your partner. They're like your lifeline, and you just want to work off of them. And I've been really lucky, and Tobin's definitely among the most fun. He's never had such a wonderful, incredible experiences with me, so he doesn't need the microphone. Only kidding.
I play a lot of power guys, you know, Western guys, cowboys, and cops, and detectives, and died a million times, and been shot, and killed, and beat up, and you don't get a lot of love scenes in that kind of career. So when I have opportunities to connect in that way, I grab them, and especially in the Saw films, because there was all of this other music going on, and there wasn't any of that theme. There was none of that music. So I was like, I want me some of that.
So, kind of talk about the legacy of it. I guess, is there a scene or a story or something that's kind of left a lasting impact on you guys, either individually or together, that you kind of still carry with you from your characters?
I hid boiled eggs in Darren Bousman's director's chair side thing once because he was such a baby about like no boiled eggs on set. I was like, who does he think he is? So I stuffed some down in there and he was tormented for like 2 days. This went on. That was awesome. I tried to do a whoopee cushion joke on a Tobin, but it backfired. He wasn't connecting with me in the scene, and it was like a pivotal scene. We both have pictures of it on our tables out there, you know, where he's talking to me. It's kind of like an initiation scene. It was the last thing we filmed, and he's like, where are you? Like, what the hell? It's our last scene. He didn't say that. He's just like, and I said, I'm trying to do this fart joke and it's not working. The thing wasn't working. Should have used the electronic. So that was a failure. I put it aside and told him, was like, please. And then the scene ended up being what it was supposed to be.
Do you know which scene she was talking about? Which film was it in? Was it in three or four? All right, we call it the initiation scene or the baptism scene. It's the scene where he says you're going out there and you think about it before you go, because once you go, you can't come back. But essentially,
the red pill or the blue pill.
Yeah, and I don't know if you got the point in the back, but that was when she was doing the joke. And so we shot the scene a couple of times, and there were breaks in between takes. And while we were on the break, and by the way, this was the very, very last scene, I think, in the film, that we were going to shoot in the film. It doesn't appear last, but we were shooting it last. And she had, in between takes, she was doing the boiled egg joke.
The whoopee cushion.
The whoopee cushion joke, all right. So, but I had been, you know, we had already done everything in the sick room, and she had been taking care of me and coming and giving me a kiss on the cheek, and you know, and so we had had this textual thing going on between us, and she had opened the letter in the other room, and it was this deep thing, and so we're shooting this last baptism scene, and she's doing the joke in between takes. But the scene didn't feel right, and I felt like I had lost her. I couldn't find her. So when I would look at her in the scene, there was a different person there, because in between takes, she had been doing this, running around, planting stuff in Darren's chair, and I was like, hold on, let's put on the brakes here a second. I need you back. Come back to me. I need you. Look, I'm right here. You know, I'm right here. And she said, oh, yeah, okay, I get it. I hear you. And that's the take they used, the one after that, because she did get it. And I got it. I got her back.
Thank God.
As far as the traps go, was there ever a time, how familiar were you with the traps going into filming the movies, and was there ever a time you went like, wow, that's really cool, or wow, that's really fucked up?
I can give her the microphone, because I had the blessing of being behind it all, but not having to be there in most of the trap rooms. I mean, I was in a couple of them, along with Cecil, and there are people that are hired to design those crazy things, that's not me. I didn't give much thought to the traps, or I was thinking way more about his philosophical, theological, literary, musical, you know, thing than about his faculties as a mechanical engineer and was responsible for it. But those traps were designed well before the thing was ever on set. And now when I actually had to handle them, I paid way more attention. For example, in Jigsaw, that last scene in the Jigsaw film recently, I have to handle a very complicated machine. I worked on that for almost a week so that I could take it apart and put it back together again without even looking at it, because John built it. And I wanted it to read that way. So that's another one of the blessings for me in these films. I have not had to have a lot of blood and gore from being in these trap rooms, because he designs them, sets them up, and they're there. Now, Shawnee's been in a few, so she might be able to address this more specifically.
Well, we all know the jaw trip and the needle pit. Somebody came by the table today and brought up Oompa, was that the actor's name?
Oh, yeah.
In the twist?
Oompa was on the incinerator.
Oompa, no. He was on the rack.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. He was awesome. I watched him film that scene, and he was like, he gave it all. I thought that was pretty awesome. That was on my mind today. And I know Darren Bousman's answered the question, like when he talks about the Trappist thing, was that they all had to work, like be practical. That was a criterion. That's a terrifying thought.
She's got another one. Right here.
How do you compare like working with James Wan, like Darren Bousman? Darren Bousman's actually like from Kansas City, so like.
Oh, that's right.
And like any like more fun stories on that might be kind of exciting for us.
That's probably better with Tobin. I worked with James for a day, and you could tell on that one day that he was like gonna traject like he has. You know, he was just that mad scientist director who had 100 very specific shots in his head and got everything that he could. And then like as the time was going down, you could see the file going like through the 100 other shots he wanted, and he knew like which ones the list of priority, you know, and he was like devastated when he couldn't get it, but he moved right on into the next scene. I mean, he's like, so in one afternoon, you could tell, I started hearing stories of like other movies he was doing, and like car chase scenes, and he wanted to strap himself to the bottom of the car. So I'm going like, yeah, it makes sense. And, but Darren's super creative in his own right, totally different styles, personality, but I mean, Darren was just doing these crazy plays out in LA that were interactive and could go different directions. I'm like, his mind is, I think they would say ADD or what, but like just a million. I would not want to live in that head. It reminds me of Linda from Becker. She says, you don't know what it's like in here. Super creative.
James Wan is so one. Had 17 or 18 days to shoot that whole film. So he was up against it time-wise, big time.
That's unreal.
Yeah. The one thing that, James was really easy to work with. He's a very, very mild-mannered guy. I remember he helped me with one thing, and that was getting up off the floor. We had one take. We only had one take for me to take that thing off my head, because the reset, once it was off, was at least a couple hours to get it back on to look right. So we only had one take. But we rehearsed it a couple of times, and James came over to me once and he said, give me a little more in your body from the fact that you've been there. So, you know, like if you were lying on the floor for that amount of time, the ache in your body, the stiffness in your body, the slowness with which you get up. And so I added 10% to what I was already doing, and it was huge. Camera sees everything. That's what they used. We got it in one take. So James was up against it. He got 18 days to shoot a film. It's not much time.
All right, we got time for one more.
What role would you guys like to play that you haven't already? And I love also that I see ASL at Crypticon. I just want to say that too. Tell Payne to say hey.
It's all good. I'm just talking to you. Sorry.
I feel bad. Did any of the questions in the back, you can hardly see back there. Have you guys just been raising your hand the whole time?
Yeah, it's completely dark back there.
Yes. It's all back there.
You're one for the darkness.
In answer to your question, the more complex the character, the better. You know, because we're not all one thing or another thing. You know, we've got all these parts of us that are going on.
I just want my daughter to write one song. And that'll be enough for me.
If you're going to go to the Jigsaw, put you in a trap, what kind of trap do you think that would be?
Would you speak up just a little bit?
If Jigsaw were to put you in a trap, what kind of trap do you think that would be?
Tobin Bell? If Jigsaw put Tobin Bell in a trap, what would be the nature of the trap?
I guess the answer is this question.
Maybe you should go back to the darkness from which you came.
You guys are awesome, by the way. It's just like, it's. I'm looking at them and I'm like, if I could have my kids' attention, like we have your attention for this. I mean, someone was on his phone, he got chastised, you know? It's so rare in this life, in this world, that you get such attention, and it's really like, just like, you guys lavish it on us in these Q&As, and you really listen to the answers. It's such a, like, rare and beautiful. It's like, I really appreciate it, even though I... We might not have an answer for your question, but...
For me, my Jigsaw trap would be a 19-inning game between the Colorado Rockies and the Montreal Expos. That's that simple.
Let's give it up.
Game over.